Today's video is sponsored by Open Studio. Go to openstudiojazz.com to check out more courses by yours truly, as well as courses by amazing musicians like Peter Martin, Christian McBride, Diane Reeves, Gregory Hutchinson, Ruben Rogers, Fred Hirsch, Jeffrey Keyser, just to name a few. Go to openstudiojazz.com to learn more. What's up, everyone? Adam Manis here. Today, we're talking about the top 10 solo breaks of all time. Just a heads up, there is a PDF that goes with this video. If you want to take a look at these yourself, go check it out. A little backstory here. This was originally going to be the top 5 solo breaks of all time. And I started asking around to musician friends what their favorite solo breaks are. I even went on the jazz subreddit, rjazz there. What's up, all my fellow jazz nerds over on Reddit. And asked them what their favorite solo breaks were. Originally, it was going to be just all different tunes, right? So many people mentioned a solo break from the amazing A Night in Tunisia, right? The jazz standard, Dizzy Gillespie, A Night in Tunisia. I was just blown away by how many people had favorite solo breaks just from that tune. Then I thought, well, that makes complete sense. The tune is sort of designed exactly for that. So I started looking around for 5 solo breaks from A Night in Tunisia. I quickly found 10 that were awesome. I think I could have done 20, but we already rip off our buddy Rick Beato around here at Open Studio a little too much as it is. So I thought I would just keep it at 10 and we'll see what we can do. Let's listen to a little bit of A Night in Tunisia. You know what A Night in Tunisia is. It's a jam session standard. I mean, even beyond that, though, you know, great musicians still play this tune. Dizzy Gillespie, 1942, written on the bottom of a trash can, which we'll hear about later. But let's listen to just a little bit of Charlie Parker's version here with Miles Davis. I'm sure you've heard this and played this a million times. It's a standard for a reason. It's a great tune. It's a great head. It's really fun to improvise over. And I think the reason why so many people focused on this tune as some of their favorite solo breaks from some of their favorite musicians is, A, it's been recorded a lot by pretty much everyone. I mean, everybody's took a swing at Night in Tunisia. But also, there's a natural drama and tension that happens right before this solo break. There's an interlude. This interlude here, as played by Bird and Miles, check it out. Here's the interlude that leads up to a 4-bar solo break that's really just F, as we'll learn about. It's marked not just F in things like the real book, and people just assume that there are these different chord changes there, but as we'll see from a bunch of different players, it can be done in several different ways. So here's the interlude to Night in Tunisia that's going to set up our solo breaks and our top 10 solo breaks of all time. Hold on. Just before we get to there, I think you know what's coming there. But that's later down the line. So that's the interlude. Now, the interesting thing about the interlude is, like I said, this solo break, this 4 bars here, it's all about drama and tension. Where would we be without drama and tension? It's brought us stuff like this. Some tension like this.
You're trembling.
I'm not trembling.
And all of this drama and tension that we're going to deal with today. So all of that we just heard is set up by this beautiful interlude, right? This interlude that just keeps building on itself, descending the bass line, going through some tensions and releases in and of itself. We're going to see a bunch of tension and release within each of these little 4-bar breaks. It's amazing what 10 different masters can do with just a little 4-bar section. So let's get right to it. So our number 10 is Dexter Gordon from Our Man in Paris. This is an amazing record. You know, one of my favorite albums, actually, from the 60s, 1963, recorded in Paris with some expats that were there, Bud Powell and Kenny Clarke, as well as Pierre Michelot on the bass, and it's just an amazing record start to finish. This Night in Tunisia is simply beautiful, and check out Dexter's solo break here, including the interlude, of course. Right away, I want you to notice something. So in the real book, this break, right, this solo break, is two bars of F major, then a bar of E half diminished, and an A7 flat 9, like a minor 2-5 thing, as if it's going back to D minor, but then it fakes and goes to E flat, which is the tritone. Notice what happens here with Dexter. Our first go, number 10, out of the gate here, doesn't do that, and we're going to see this as a pattern. This idea that it's two bars of F and then a cadence back, it's just not true. It's just not how the great players handled this. Some of them did, a couple of them did, but honestly, a lot of them didn't. And so I just want to take a minute here to appreciate what Dexter Gordon is doing with this tension. So right away, there's this F major triad, right? And there's this G minor triad. So creating tension within the F major seems to be the order of the day. Then by the third bar of the break, it's definitely implying some kind of D minor sound. And then certainly to like that A7 flat 9 sound by the last bar, which is going to be a trend, actually. We're going to see that sort of 5 chord happen right towards the end. But it's not as clear cut as like a bar of E half diminished and a bar of A7 at all. And in fact, here, I love this because Dexter, I mean, that's a definite hint of a D minor 6 there in the third bar. Let's listen one more time. Super swinging. So next up is the amazing Bud Powell from the amazing Bud Powell. Super swinging rhythm section, Curly Russell on the bass, Max Roach on the drums. Let's have a listen. How great is that? And then again, you can just hear the tension that's coming in and out of the F major. It has nothing to do with really like what's happening in a particular bar until you kind of get to that last bar before the form comes back around. And it definitely implies an A7 there with that C sharp. But check out the bar before that, what the real book would call an E half diminished. Again, that's F major to my ear. Let's listen again to the break. Just blazing and such beautiful, clear language. Bud Powell, one of the all-time great musicians of the 20th century. Just incredible. Number 8 is from the 1963 album, A Night in Tunisia. This is Don Byas. And if we're going from Bud Powell, which is like right down the middle, this is certainly not right down the middle. Check this out. I mean, you want to talk about drama and tension. Oh my goodness gracious. So, I mean, we talked about how it's not so clear that it's like it's like a E half diminished and A7. It's not so clear that it's an F at all. And it works so, so well. It's so dramatic and so swinging and beautiful. Let's listen to that one more time. Number 8, Don Byas. How great is that? And then, I mean, this whole solo is incredible, but just that to set the stage for a solo break. I mean, what's so cool about this is just listening to all these great players weave in and out of this 4-bar break in such different ways. It's such a chance for self-expression, and everybody has their own take on it. We can be beautiful and straight down the middle, but we don't have to be. We can be Don Byas. Number 7. Is a solo break by Herbie Hancock, possibly on a guitar. This is from a 1981 Chaka Khan album called What You Gonna Do For Me, featuring Dizzy Gillespie and Herbie Hancock. The track is "And the Melody Still Lingers On, Night in Tunisia." Do you have Chaka Khan where you are? If you don't, you should get some. Check this out. Herbie. So, I mean, again, we talk about building tension, right? And the expectations of having some kind of chord change. Now, this is a totally different key. This is a whole step down. So the break is on E flat, and this little synth break that Herbie does here, I mean, it feels so great. And again, it's so not building off of some kind of blocked 2-5-1 or anything like that. But he holds that first note for two bars there, two full bars, and then just breaks it down into that. I mean, every keyboard player knows that little walk-up thing that he does there at the end. It's so, so effective. At what? Drama and tension, right? Let's hear it again. Number six is the alto saxophonist Lou Donaldson's solo break on the first of two Art Blakey versions of A Night in Tunisia on our list here. This is from A Night at Birdland, Art Blakey, 1954. Check out this personnel here. Art Blakey on the drums, Clifford Brown on the trumpet, Lou on the alto saxophone, Horace Silver on the piano, and Curly Russell on the bass. Doesn't get much better than that. It's an incredible recording, and it's pretty great for our purposes here because it's set up. A Night in Tunisia itself is introduced by Art Blakey, and he tells the story of how he was there when Dizzy wrote it. Check it out.
Wow. Yeah. At this time, we'd like to play a tune. It was written by the famous Dizzy Gillespie. I feel rather close to this tune because I was right there when he composed it in Texas on the bottom of a garbage can. Seriously. So, Night in Tunisia, ladies and gentlemen.
Isn't that amazing? A tune that is played like 70 years later, 80 years later almost, all around the world, written in Texas, somewhere in 1942 in the bottom of a garbage can. I mean, it's awesome. So I think of Lou Donaldson, you know, you think of some really groovy Blue Note records, some funky stuff in the late 60s and early 70s, a beautiful tone and language, and the fire he brings to this break. I mean, this is like Lou, like you might not be thinking of Lou. Check it out. How great is that? Again, a lot of F here and just a lot of different ways to use tension. You know, I have in here the E half diminished 7 because I think you can make a case for it that he's setting up this A7 in a way that's not as sort of F major heavy as some of our other people on the list, or that's as out as some others. But I mean, this is such a burn and solo. That moment in the third bar, right, where he sweeps up to that concert G is so dramatic. So beautiful. I mean, isn't it incredible to hear these different players do the same break and what they bring to it? It just gets me going. So Lou bringing the fire, and we're going to go right on to number five here. And this is another Art Blakey version. This is from A Ways Down the Road, 1961's A Night in Tunisia, whole different band. This is the Jazz Messengers band, Art Blakey, Lee Morgan on trumpet, Wayne Shorter on tenor saxophone, who is playing our break for number five, the great Wayne Shorter, young Wayne Shorter here, Bobby Timmons on piano, and Jimmy Merritt on bass. And so we've already had a few different types, right? From Herbie's wailing keytar to like the straight down the middle Dexter Gordon, the fire of Lou Donaldson, the Don Bias, the where to go Don Bias. But check this out from Wayne. Wayne can do this break with just three notes. Here it is. So again, where's the A7 here? This is all F. In fact, this is all just the notes of C, F, and G. Wayne can play this four-bar break with three notes, and I'm telling you, that is intense. Now, you can look at or listen to where he ends up here on the E-flat 7 all the way up on that C to sort of give it an apex, but it just shows that there's several different ways that you can approach this, and this break by Wayne is, I mean, first of all, how intense is that entire track? Gotta check out this whole album if you haven't listened to the whole thing. It's so intense and beautiful. Let's listen to it again. The amazing, the beautiful, the cosmic, the artist that is Wayne Shorter, proving to us all that we can break down things into simpler and simpler shapes, and it's available to us in 1961. I mean, his genius is staggering. So number four is the man himself, Dizzy Gillespie. Number four, and this is, obviously, you could go down a rabbit hole of Dizzy's versions of A Night in Tunisia on YouTube alone. There's so many great live versions. You could hear how the way he played this tune evolved over the decades and how he handled the break. He became more and more of an abstract painter. Beautiful job, with every single one and compelling, dramatic things happening every single time, even into the later years. Just beautiful, beautiful stuff the whole way through. And this 1957 version is from a big band recording called Burke's Works. And this is, I chose this because I love it. And it's so swinging and laid back. Let's have a listen. Again, to my ear, Dizzy's just playing all F, and the guy wrote the tune. I mean, it's just all F. I don't hear much tension building towards an A7 at all. I just hear him playing a lot around making tension within the F. You could see him do it, hear him do it here in the lines, right? Maybe with some, like, implying some 5-1 tension on F, but it's a lot of like little chromaticism surrounding notes, but all with a very F sound to me, at least to my ear. Just beautiful. Let's listen one more time to Dizzy's version from Burke's Works. Number three is the amazing Ella Fitzgerald from her 1961 album, Clap Hands, Here Comes Charlie. This is staggeringly good. I mean, I don't need to say anything. Just listen to this.
Where the nights are filled with peace.
I mean, it's a dream. What a dream to be able to play like that, to be able to sing like that, but just to be able to play like this with these kinds of ideas and clarity. You know, for this one, you could, I guess, make the argument that there is a bit of a 2-5 turnaround. I hate to even beat that dead horse, but I don't know. I do think there just is something that there's a lot more D flat than a lot of players might think, especially like real book style players. And you get to that F7 there towards the end of the phrase, as Ella does here, just setting up that we're going back to sort of that tonic minor. Let's listen again and just enjoy.
The moon is the same above you.
Amazing. Number two is one from one of my favorite albums ever, A Night at the Village Vanguard, live record, Sonny Rollins Trio, Pianolist Trio, 1958, Blue Note, iconic album. If you haven't checked out the whole thing, it's unbelievable. I mean, it really, truly is unbelievable, the vibe that they get. Wilbur Ware, Elvin Jones, Donald Bailey, Pete LaRocca, depending on what night you're what night you're listening to, but the whole thing is incredible. And this version of A Night in Tunisia is, I think, iconic. Again, just four bars of F major there. Really, look at that last bar. That's an F triad that Sonny lays out for us there. Unbelievable. We don't have to do as much as we think. I mean, that's what I'm taking away. Is, first of all, it's just F. That's my main takeaway from this little list here, is it's just F. And some people put tensions on it and some people don't. But the way people put tensions on it really depends on the signature of the player. It's not useful for us to get just blinders on and think about changes and things like that. It's not really what it's about. It's not how it works. Number one, our last one, I think you probably know which one this is. We hinted at it in the beginning. This is, of course, Charlie Parker with Miles Davis. This is one of the most famous solo breaks on any tune, if not the most famous solo break on any tune, and for good reason. It's so damn good. Let's have a listen here to Bird at its best, his very, very best. I mean, the rhythmic clarity in the line there is so special. I mean, it really captures your attention. When he lands on the E flat there, I mean, you're just ready to pop out of your seat. It's unbelievable. Let's listen one more time. Really, words fail this big time. Charlie Parker from, you know, I think I grabbed this from the Dial sessions, the Savoy Dial. I mean, it's easy to find. It's just so, so beautiful. Thank you for joining me. If this is a video that you stuck around all the way to the end, make sure to hit that like or subscribe button. Take the PDF with you. We've got all of these transcribed by our very own Max Gamiz, our in-house transcriber here at Open Studio. And don't forget to check out openstudiojazz.com to go on deep dives of things like bebop and language and improvisation. All right, folks, until next time, happy practicing.